Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Microsoft Security Update Summary, where I will present a short recap of what was released today, October 14th, 2025. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. I'm going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then I'll dive into a few vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities I'm covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. So before I dive into today's release, I'd like to compare it to the previous 12 months to get an understanding of how it stacks up. This month, there were 183 newly disclosed CVEs. Of those, 32 fall into the remote code execution impact category. That's a little bit lower than our average over the past 13 months of just over 34. Remote code execution is typically the type of impact that has the most risk associated to it. It would allow a threat actor to install software or other high-level activities. Next, I'll move into scoring, where Microsoft uses the Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a scale between 0 and 10, where 10 represents the highest level of risk. This month, the highest scored CVE comes in at 9.9. which is a bit above our average of around 9.5 over the past 13 months. The average CVSS score across the entire release comes in at 7.08, which is a little bit lower than our average over the past 13 months of right around 7.4. Now, I often say that the CVSS scoring is a starting point when we talk about risk. It's great because it allows us to talk about different vulnerabilities across different platforms, services, vendors, hardware, software, firmware. We can compare all of these vulnerabilities on the same scale. However, it doesn't include everything when we think of risk. It doesn't include, for example, the impact, whether it's remote code execution or information disclosure. Those two impacts might have a slightly different risk profile, but that's not seen in the CVSS score. Another thing that the CVSS score does not contain is whether or not a vulnerability was publicly disclosed or not. These are the types of vulnerabilities where, in one way or another, prior to release, the existence of the vulnerability has been made public. It could be on one side of the spectrum. It could be a security researcher making a social media post that they found an issue in some type of software. On the other end, it could be a threat actor publishing a proof of concept that allows exploit code to be built. Different, but this month, we have three vulnerabilities that fall into the publicly disclosed category. That's a little bit above our average over the past 13 months of just over two. One other thing that's not included in the base CVSS score is whether a vulnerability is known to be exploited or not. These are vulnerabilities where one way or another, either Microsoft directly or through our partners, have noticed some sort of exploitation associated with a vulnerability. This month, there are three vulnerabilities that fall into that category. We've been averaging right at two over the past 13 months. Okay, let's dive into this month, the October release. And those of you that have watched this video before, you'll recognize this chart where we put the Windows products towards the bottom, and then we move up into products that are not necessarily serviced every single month. That's certainly the case this month. With the Windows side, we've been averaging in the upper 50s into the upper 60s, depending on the specific operating system. And as we can see, we're well above that this month. As we move up the chart, we see Office and SharePoint making an appearance as they usually do. But we also have a handful of vulnerabilities in the developer tools section. That's .NET, ASP.NET Core, Visual Studio. There's a handful of vulnerabilities with fixes this month. Exchange, SQL, and System Center are enterprise tools that have updates available for you this month. And rounding it all out, there's a handful of vulnerabilities in the larger Azure umbrella that have updates to address vulnerabilities. Okay, the first vulnerability that I'll talk to is CVE-2025-49708. This is a critical elevation of privilege vulnerability in the Windows graphics component. This has a base CVSS score of 9.9. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Low privileges are required, but no user interaction is required here. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this, but I will point out a couple things here. One, this is a vulnerability that exists in Hyper-V, specifically in a virtual machine hosted within Hyper-V. And an attacker that was able to exploit this would be able to attack the host OS and gain system privileges on that host operating system. So first, a threat actor would need to have access into a Hyper-V virtual machine. And then from there, they would be able to leverage CVE-2025-49708 to gain system privileges on the host operating system. As far as the affected software, it is Server 2019, 2022, and 2025, as well as Windows 10 and 11 on the desktop side. Next up is CVE-2025-59287. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability in WSUS or Windows Server Update Services. This one was privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base CVSS score of 9.8. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none. User interaction is also none for this vulnerability. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this. As far as the affected software, it's all versions of Server OS that are in a mainstream support. That's from Server 2016 all the way up through Server 2025, which is the latest. And finally, there's a pair of vulnerabilities that are similar in the scoring that I want to bring awareness to. These are CVE-2025-24052 and 24990. These are important elevation of privilege vulnerabilities in the Aegir modem driver. One of these was publicly disclosed and the other was exploit detected. They both have a CVSS base score of 7.8. The attack vector is local. The attack complexity is low. Low privileges are required to leverage this, but user interaction here is none. There are no documented mitigations for this, but this is being addressed in a way that is uncommon. Most of these vulnerabilities are fixed by changing code and applying providing an update to make those changes in the code. With this vulnerability, the decision was made to remove this vulnerable driver from Windows, starting with the October updates. So when you install this update, this vulnerable driver will no longer be present on the systems with the October update installed. One thing I'll point out is that all supported versions of Windows can be affected by a successful exploitation of this vulnerability, even if the modem is not actively being used. And this is why the driver's just being removed entirely from Windows. As far as the affected software, it's Server 2016 up through the latest Server 2025, as well as Windows 10 and 11 on the desktop side. All right, that's it for the video today. I want to thank everyone for taking time out of your day, and I will talk to you all next month. Thank you.